So, since I'm stealing some of IP's time, I'm going to launch a presentation right away. While the market is shifting, we're seeing at least four shifts in the market. The Moore's Law is hitting limitation. This is no longer a new thought. This is a thought being accepted by the industry. Technology partners and users can no longer count on the next generation of silicon to give them the consistent cost performance improvement that they have been accustomed to. Microprocessors alone can no longer give them the cost performance benefits, sufficient benefits. I actually grew up designing hardware, not as early as age of five, probably 18. Then I realized we're hitting the limitation of it, so I decided to take an open power job is by talking with various thought leaders in the industry to figure out how to continue pushing the technology forward. So in fact, even a few years ago, we've seen the limitation of Moore's Law. That's why we came up with virtualization. We have an advanced memory technology, I/O acceleration. So we'll be trying to compensate the limitation of Moore's Law for a few generations. And now there is more of it we need to do, and acceleration is certainly a big component of it. And in addition, we're seeing growing on workloads. We're seeing more and more of rapid development of big data, analytics, and also now AI, deep learning framework. All of them are growing and changing on a day-to-day basis. In fact, we're seeing people building hardware to tailor to their software. For example, Facebook is doing with their OCP, and various large corporations are getting on that wagon of OCP. And also, of course, software is always trying to catch up with the development of hardware as well. In addition, the IP consumption model is changing as well. We're seeing, you can use cloud, pay as you go cloud. The hyperscale data centers are building their own hardware. Also, they're buying directly from ODMs. And last but not least, the maturity of open software. And I know this morning there are a few questions about open software. Open source software is becoming more and more popular. They're becoming good enough to do what you need to do instead of paying the active licensing fees. In fact, a classic example, Microsoft, they opened up their CMTK. I talked with Microsoft AI group, I asked them, where do you get your CMTK? They download directly from GitHub. That's how open they are trying to be. So that's a huge statement. Everybody wants to have open source development. Based on all this, our answer is Open Power Foundation. It's about 3 years ago, IBM, Google, Mellanox, NVIDIA, and Tyenne, we formed this Open Power Foundation. In fact, Nimbix is a member of it, very active. And Xilinx as well. Now, there are at least a few partners in this audience. And our goal is to create this open development so that we have the thought leaders of the industry, not just microprocessors, board, and chip. We want to go all the way to applications, to HPC, to deep learning and machine learning, the whole end-to-end stack. We invite thought leaders to be part of the organization because we know that 1.2x of performance is no longer good enough. You want that 10x performance improvement Paul talked about this morning and accomplish that in 11 days, right? The partners want to have ability to differentiate. They want ability to innovate and growth. At the end of the day, the good enough hardware is no longer, the one size fits all hardware is no longer good enough. You want to have the best of breed components. Perhaps you want to the best and newest GPU from NVIDIA, awesome scale-out network from Mellanox, and also Xilinx FPGA. You want to deploy in an Nimbix cloud. So that's why we're pulling all this together to give you that environment. At the end of the day, you can also grow more of your market share or tap into your adjacent market share. Let's see, I think at this page, let's move forward to the next part. This we talked about this is what Open Power Foundation and why we opened up our foundation. In fact, for us, the reason we grow to more than 300 members in less than 3 years is we actually opened up our power architecture. I don't think there's anybody in this industry actually do that, because we opened up our power so that people can design from chip and all the way up to applications. We want to have more deeper and meaningful collaborations with thought leaders of our industry. So right now we're sitting about more than 300 members, and we're at 31 countries and 6 continents. We have more than 20 system manufacturer partners, and we have a line, entire IBM LC product line. They actually designed by Open Power Foundation members. We have about 40 ISVs, 40 plus ISVs, and we have 40 plus Open Power systems in development or shipping. Last year, actually about this time, we had Open Power Summit, and there were 60 hardware and software technologies on display. Now, I mentioned there is a portfolio of Open Power products. Now, I want to highlight one which is most relevant to this audience here, that we all want to have huge data. We live in a world that, based on IDC prediction, there's going to be 44 zettabytes of data by 2020. That's 21 zeros. So how do we do that? Well, NVIDIA came out with awesome GPUs, but the problem is there's a bottleneck, PCIe bottleneck between CPU and GPU. So IBM, NVIDIA, and Mellanox, we developed this Minsky system. It's 822LC for HPC. So our goal is to create a balanced design. I grew up in the hardware. I know microarchitecture 101 is how to eliminate bottleneck in a system design. So that's why not only GPUs, you have the 80 gigabytes per second of speed, but also between CPU and GPU, you have the same latency. So overall, you're running at an 8-lane up highway. There's no bottleneck when you enter the highway to your exit the highway. That's from a latency perspective. Now let's look at it from bandwidth perspective. Each GPU have access to the CPU system memory, and each CPU has up to half a terabyte of system memory. Now altogether, all GPUs together, you have up to 1 terabyte of system memory. That's a 5x of bandwidth improvement than in competitive products. That's why we think Minsky system is certainly the elite system for HPC, for machine learning, deep learning, and artificial intelligence. This is the Power 8 NVLink version. And when we're gonna have Power 9 come out later this year, we're gonna have the coherency is gonna be there between GPU and CPU. Okay, so I'm not gonna go too deep on Power AI, because that's IQ's gonna give you guys an awesome demo about that. Think of Power AI as a collection of deep learning framework, and think of it as a Red Hat of deep learning. Our goal is quickly bypass the installation from weeks down to 45 minutes. You can install it quickly and up and running, so you can do your software development. Of course, you have a Minsky system, you can download that for free, or you can jump on Nimbus. So this is a part of the framework we're supporting right now, and there's gonna be more and more open deep learning framework is gonna be added, and I think we're planning to do about release once a quarter. Okay, now I'll get to the punchline. So I think right now we're working with established already with Nimbix, there are two offers on the Minsky system, because Minsky system you can have up to 4 GPUs. The first offer is you can have 1 GPU. The second one, if you want to put very large data, you can have all 4 GPUs. You have 30 days of 60 hours of free trial for 1 GPU, or 30 days, 120 hours of free trial. And that's all paid for and supported by Nimbix. And if you have a lead on this, you can contact me or the local IBM sales team. You can get even more hours on Nimbix. The goal is for developers, research, universities, medical centers. If you have any AI projects or cognitive project, you want to tap in the potential of Minsky, you can certainly jumpstart with Nimbix. And I think that's probably the most cost-efficient way to do that. And feel free to contact me and get you connected, and we'll have a selection process so that you can develop your software within this free trial. The last one, actually, in about a month from now, May 22nd to May 25th, Open Power, we're going to have our first ever developer congress. And this foundation will have two summits already. For this year, we're actually going to do two parts. One of them is the hands-on developers congress. Basically, there is not going to be anybody trying to sell your system, sell your software. There's not going to be anybody standing here to give you 5-10 minutes of pitch. This is all, think of it like hackathon. This is all about how you can tap into potential of power. So very technical summit. So we're going to have a GPU, deep learning, also deep learning framework, inferencing, also development of how to develop on Power Platform. Also OpenVMC and OpenStack and Open Database as a Service. So this is my quick overview, then I'm going to turn over to IP. Okay.
Thank you, Ming.
And hello, can you hear me at the back? All right, good, thanks. I'm Indrajit Poddar. I go by the short name IP. Don't call me intellectual pup. But hey, I have some slides, but I promise to keep them to very few slides. But more importantly, I think I'd like to show you what we at IBM have been doing with Index already. And I think it's a very, very powerful cloud environment. And I want to actually show you a demo of a deep learning Power AI framework running on Index. And I want to show you how fast we can get started. So here, I have a few screenshots of a bicycle, right? I mean, all of us can, although these are weird pictures, but it's very easy to make out that these are bicycles. And I'm sorry, it's going by itself. So the point I was trying to make is that So you can make out it's a bicycle, right? But it's very hard for a machine to do that. And that's changing with deep learning. We are introducing techniques by which machines can learn the way that human brains work. And if you recall, when you were babies, you didn't know that was a bicycle. You have to be taught, you have to be trained. And in a similar way, we're building these artificial neural networks now as part of these deep learning frameworks, which mimic the way the synapses, the neurons work in our brain. And the same way as they are trained as human beings, we are also training artificial neural networks. And so deep learning is, just to get straight with the term, it's a type of machine learning, and these are all types of artificial intelligence and cognitive applications. And two more important things, I think, which we already covered in many of the presentations today. There is the training part, which is a very compute-intensive part, which takes a lot of compute resources and time. And then there's the inference part, which is after you have the training done, you get something called a model, and then use that model to act on the real-life data and give you some answers, which are either saying whether it's a bicycle or it's something else. And that's what we go through. And what I like about Nimbix is that it allows you to make use of a large amount of compute resources, not only in a scale-up manner, but also in a scale-out manner. So things like Docker and Spark, and in conjunction with scale-out frameworks like management frameworks like Kubernetes and Mesos, they make it easy to scale out and consume a large number of resources in multiple machines. But when it comes to deep learning training, it's not just enough. Scale up. It's easy to scale up, but you have to take into account that when you have data sets with video input with very high resolution images, it's not enough to just do your computation on the CPU. That's why you need to offload some of your computation to these co-processors like GPUs, and that's what we see today. And so what we're doing with Index and all this consortium, Foundation of Open Cloud members, is that we're taking these very different hardware component providers from NVIDIA and Xilinx, and we're putting it together into these systems with the system integrators like Supermicro, and then putting them, making them available to developers to public cloud environment. So over here on the left-hand side, you can see a screenshot from one of our data center racks and software, where we have combined a rack of open cloud machines with distribution of existing machines in the cloud. And our nearest member, Nimbix, thanks so much for having us here, is a very good example of such a public cloud provider. And we're going to see some examples of how they're using it. And this is actually the whole ecosystem, a screenshot of open cloud vendors at all levels of the stack. And you can see there's a lot of innovation happening in multiple levels. The thing about Nimbix that I like most is that it's a platform service. It's not just the infrastructure service. And that means that you're taking care of DevOps concerns at an infrastructure level. What you're providing to the developers are very easy ways of consuming these accelerators like GPUs and FPGAs. And what we have done is put together additional software packages on top of Nimbix, which we're calling PowerAI. And TensorFlow is one of those deep learning frameworks that we have put into those software packages. And when you run these software packages on top of the open power systems with GPUs, what we find is through our own benchmark, like this one, we have taken something called Inception V3, which is a popular TensorFlow benchmark. And we've seen that when you compare one of our systems running with four NVIDIA V100 GPUs connected with the NVLink adapter that Ming was talking about, you get about 30% higher throughput in terms of the number of images processed per second. So that's the performance advantage that we bring in through an alternative system architecture. And also in terms of cost, compared to DGX-1, the PowerAI platform system comes at a lower price point, $67,000 compared to $109,000. So if you compare in terms of the throughput of these deep learning frameworks, we are about 1.6 times better in terms of number of images processed per second per dollar. And we attribute this to the bottleneck that we overcome in the competition between the CPU memory and the GPU memory. So that's about the hardware. Now about the software, this is the PowerAI package. It's available for download from here. And it's also something that can very easily containerize, as I'm showing you, and brought up in Nimbix. And so this includes things like Caffe and TensorFlow and Torch. And you can use these learning frameworks with popular Python packages like Matplotlib, Pandas, and Jupyter Notebook, as we'll see. And basically, these are available on top of the Ubuntu operating system, even though it's a different processor architecture. When it comes to developing on it, it's basically playing with Ubuntu and Python, and also Java, as before, for JIT. So it's a very easy to work environment, and along with the use of Dockerization, you'll find that it's a breeze to come up with a deep learning classification. So, and we went through this workflow for Nimbix. As a developer, you write your Docker file, and you can put that in GitHub. Then you build a Docker file into a Docker image, which you put into Docker Hub. You put in that Docker image into Nimbix, and Nimbix can launch it as a container, and you can automatically get these NVIDIA GPUs, one or four of them attached to your containers, and you're off and running with your deep learning application. One last word, we do make use of NVIDIA Docker, which is a way of abstracting out the device drivers of the GPUs from the container images. That makes your images more portable. So when you make build these Docker images, we recommend that you build them with NVIDIA Docker, so your Docker images are more portable across different machines. But Docker images built for open power do not run on x86 and vice versa. They have to be built on a bar machine. So last word here, or last slide, I think that's where you have a hands-on example. So when you use these deep learning frameworks on top of OpenPower, you can see speedups like this. So this here is a snippet of code from a Jupyter notebook that will actually run. And when you run it in the CPU mode, just using the CAFE framework and net.forward, that is the CAFE classification step. In the CPU mode, it might take something like 7.2 seconds for you. But when you want to exploit the GPU, all you have to do is make two lines of code changes. You set mode to GPU, select device, and then you call the same method. And your code can run almost like 150 to 200 times faster, down to 56.4 milliseconds. So this is a transparent speed up that you can accomplish with these deep learning frameworks and on top of all the power systems that you use. Many schedulers like Mesos have now support for GPUs as first class resources. IBM Spectraconductor is a software which also offers support for scheduling with GPUs and CPUs as first class resources. So when you build a cluster like the new Mesos have, you can take advantage of GPUs as first class citizens in a system of compute resources like CPUs. So with that, I'd like to go into a tutorial. And one word before I go into that, I won't go through the whole tutorial. This is a link to the whole tutorial. Just as recently as last week, I was at San Francisco at the Cognitive Builder Fair. And we had a room full of participants just like this, about 76 of them. And I'd just like to say hats off to Steve Leo. The Nimbix environment where we ran that tutorial, most of those 75 people were able to come and get up and running with their own containers at the same time with GPUs attached, and they were able to run their first classification example, one that I'm going to show right now, in less than 10 minutes. So I think that's a very powerful statement. That's how we're seeing the usage of a fast platform like Nimbix, and it really helps us to make developers more. Actually, I would say data scientists are more productive by taking out the DevOps concerns from the hands of data scientists. That's Leo was talking about bringing up your presentations today. So with that, I'd like to move to, well, first let's go to a simple example. So over here I have the Linux interface, now log in. As you have seen, Okay, so do that again. So I'm logging into the Nimbix Jarvis web frontend. And I'll go to, from the compute tab, I'll go into categories and go to IBM Power. This is where you find all the Power specific images. And these are all Docker images from Docker Hub. And you can, you know, as shown in the previous session, you can always extend these images and build your own images. So of particular interest is this Power AI image, which you can launch as in the batch mode, like what shown in the in serverless form, but for data scientists and for beginners who are trying to learn these deep learning frameworks, I think there's still a use case for a more interactive style of usage. And although I prefer the batch mode, certainly, as Leo was saying, but what I'm going to show you is actually the interactive mode with the servers, but you can connect to the server from my browser and do run a few examples in an interactive manner. So this is the Power AI examples application, which includes the Power AI software distribution and also includes distributed notebooks, and three Jupyter notebook servers, which I immediately brought up as soon as this material comes up. So I'm going to launch it. And over here, you see all the different Power architecture options that you can find in Nimbix. This includes both ones with GPUs and without GPUs. And can see that there are, the thing of interest is that in the CPU itself, you also get a very large number of hardware threads, each of which actually show up as a CPU at the operating system level in your container. But as you can see, ranging from 40 to 160 hardware threads in the CPU, combined with up to 1 terabyte of RAM and up to 4 GPUs. That's the amount of system resources that you have available on an open power container in Linux. And so we're going to take this option just for this simple example, 40 hardware threads in the CPU, 256 gigabytes of RAM and 1K GPU, and we're going to launch that container. And you'll notice immediately this comes up in less than 2 minutes because it's basically a Docker container. And you're able to connect to your terminal almost immediately. So just waiting for it to be scheduled. So as you can see, it's already beginning to boot, and you have a public IP address, host name to connect to. And as soon as I see a login prompt, I'm going to connect to this host name and the particular port, which is running a Jupyter Notebook server. Oh, and the login prompt is already here. So I'm going to copy this and paste it here. And I'm going to go to port number 888, which is 8888. Standard Jupyter Notebook server. This is going to ask me for a password because anybody in the world can connect to this IP address, public IP address. So I'm going to retrieve the password by using an SSH window. So SSH Linux at the rate of 3 notebook servers which are all running in this container, which are brought up in less than 2 minutes. I'm going to take the token from the Cafe notebook server and use that as a password to log into my the Cafe notebook server from my browser. Control C and back here, this is the notebook server. So now I'm logged into my Jupyter Notebook server and I'm going to these Cafe examples. Take the first example here. These are not my examples. These are examples that that were packaged with the Cafe framework, and I'm just basically going to run it without any code changes. And I just want to show you that how easy it is to get started first, and secondly, what the GPU speedup can feel like. So first thing, I'm going to load the NumPy framework and the matplotlib framework in Python. And then I'm going to load Cafe from PowerAI. And now I'm going to download a pre-trained model, the CafeNet pre-trained model. I'm going to come down in about, say, a minute, maybe. It looks like a little slower today, but so once the model is downloaded, then we're going to try it on a data set which is actually included within this framework, and we're going to take a sample image from that data set and do a classification. Right now the model is about 39% downloaded. It's going a little slow today. It's a little
I'm sure you spoke today in that work. Well, yeah. We got to bring it up to the demo box this one. Okay, almost there. There you go. So now the model, the pre-trained model has been downloaded. So I'm not going to train the model in this example. I'm just going to do a classification. First, I'm going to set the mode to CPU. Using just the CPU mode, I'm going to load the model into memory. Okay, and then I'm going to do a just a little bit of data preparation, and then. Then I'm going to load the image that I'm going to try and classify. So this, as you can tell, as a human eye can tell very easily, is an image of a very cute cat. So let's classify it, like they say, and let's see what the machine thinks of this particular image. And this is using just the CPU, and it says the predicted class is 281. So we're going to load a few labels which represent these class numbers. And as soon as the labels are downloaded, you can see what the class 281 is. And almost there, right? So the output label, it's a tabby cat, which is correct, it's a cat. So it did do the classification correctly. And using only the GPU, let's look at the other options first, and also the probabilities associated with each option. So it found that it's a tabby cat, and the confidence of that prediction is about 31%. And look at the other options found: tiger cat, Egyptian cat, red fox, lynx, which are all, as you can see, are related types of animals, and the probabilities are somewhat closer to all these different types of animals. Now we'll switch into this GPU mode, and we'll see refresh the timing, and then we'll switch to GPU mode to see how much of an acceleration you get. So in the GPU mode, sorry, the CPU mode runs for a little while, and let's see. So that's 50 images. It's chugging along using just the CPU. Okay, so then I came back about 9.88 seconds per loop. But let's see how fast it is with GPUs. So when I run it here using the GPU mode, that just came back, by the way, 54.2 milliseconds, as you can see. So it's about, you know, almost 100x, 200x difference with GPUs. So that's what I wanted to show you, how fast you can get started with GPUs and with deep learning, and using the Power AI framework on top of the index. And thanks a lot for this opportunity, and I hope you use more Power AI and index. Thank you.
Thank you. I wanted to give everyone an opportunity to ask questions. If you have any questions, please raise your hand.
My old friend.
Pretty impressive. The question I have is, can we use the, where does your Watson platform, is that using GPU?
So the question was, how does it relate to Watson, the Watson platform? So the Watson platform, the way I look at it is that it's a set of APIs. When you are an AI developer, there are many ways to get started. You may not necessarily want to you train your own models to get started. If you have a set of APIs, your work is often accelerated. And Watson is that. It's basically a set of APIs. So let's say if you give it a bunch of text and you want to understand what sort of mood or tone there is in that text, then that API will come back and tell you, oh, this looks like a very angry piece of text, or maybe a very sad piece of text. So that's the kind of power you get with Watson, a set of APIs. But let's say you want to go deeper and you want to train your own model with these open source frameworks like Caffe and TensorFlow. That's really like you use the Power AI software.
You mentioned about resources, right?
About
you support Mesos.
Resources?
Mesos,
yes.
Yeah, yes. So Mesos says it can reduce the cost in the cloud, you know, up to 60%.
Yes.
That applies to GPU, you say that?
So Mesos is, think of Mesos as a scheduler. It's so let's say if you have a cluster of resources and you have a workload which requires let's say two CPUs or three CPUs or one GPU, you can go to Mesos and say, hey, can you get me these 10 CPUs from a cluster? And then find that from that cluster of resources. So that's how it's able to put multiple workloads in the same cluster and improve the utilization of the cluster.
So same applies to the GPUs as well.
Yes, so now GPUs are a first class citizen in that set of resources that Mesos has. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's classifying Mesos as a resource manager is correct. So obviously, any cloud is going to have resource management. Some of them do a better job than others. We obviously, for us, being heterogeneous in the sense that not only do we have different accelerator types, we have different CPU architectures as well. Our scheduling is very much optimized for picking different kinds of resources in the same cluster. But yeah, I mean, we like Mesos. We think it's good technology. It's, you know, it's young, but it's something that we're definitely, you know, keeping an eye on.
All right, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.